There's a phenomenon going around today that has a lot of people asking questions about living and dying and living again. This phenomenon that I'm talking about is called after-death experiences or out-of-the-body experiences. You've heard about them. You've read about them. Now, here's what they say has happened. A person dies, either in an automobile accident or on the operating table, but they die and then they find themselves leaving their body and living outside their body. They report how they float around the room and they hear these marvelous sounds and they see these glorious colors. And after doing this a while, they enter back into their body and began to live all over again, or so they say. Now, I find these experiences very interesting because it seems to me they all tell the same story. They all talk about how wonderful it is to die. Whether you're a Christian or not a Christian, whether you're saved or not saved, they report how you shouldn't be afraid of dying. You shouldn't be scared of dying, whether you're saved or unsaved, whether you're born again or not. It makes no difference because there's no sting in death. There's nothing to be afraid of to die, they say. Now, I want to ask the question, who or what is telling these unsaved people they should not be afraid of dying? Well, my dear friends, it is not the God of the Bible. Because you see, the Bible says that for a man to die without Jesus, what that means is he will immediately come face to face with a holy God, and he will hear God say, "Depart from me into everlasting hell prepared for the devil and his angels." Oh, my friend, for a man to die without Jesus will be the most horrifying and terrifying thing that has ever happened. Living and dying and living again, what happens after death? The Bible tells us a lot about what happens after death. The first thing the Bible says death is certain. The Bible says it is appointed unto men once to die. Oh, my dear friends, the one thing true in life is that all men must die. All ages die. No matter how young or how old, people die at all ages. All races die, red, yellow, black, and white. All nationalities die. All levels of society die. In fact, the Bible says you are going to die. It is appointed unto men once to die. In fact, the Bible says your life is nothing but a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. In fact, the Bible says the exact moment of your death has already been determined by God. It is appointed, the Bible says. Oh, friend, listen, God is not surprised when people die. God is not caught off guard. God is in control of this whole thing of living and dying and living again. You say, William, are you trying to say that somewhere out there in heaven, God has taken His pen and He circled on the eternal calendar the exact day I'm going to die? Oh, my friend, I'm saying precisely that. God has appointed a day. God knows the day you're going to die. Now, here's the problem. You don't know that day. Several years ago, a professor in a seminary was talking to a group of young preacher boys, and he said, "Young man," he said, "don't worry about how you live your life. Just eat, drink, and be merry. Do whatever you want to do, but the day before you die, you can get right with God so you'll go to heaven." And one of the young preacher boys said, "But sir, we don't know the day we're going to die." And the wise professor said, "Well, in that case, you need to get right with God today." That's what the Bible says. God has appointed a day. You have a day when you're going to die. God knows that day, but you don't know it. That's why the Bible says, prepare to meet God. Several years ago, I came across an article about a flight that took place several years ago over in the Hawaiian Islands. It was Aloha Airlines. It was a Boeing 737. It was going from the island of Hilo to Honolulu. Everybody on board was a vacationer. They were laughing, joking, drinking, having a great time, not concerned about anything except enjoying their vacation. When the plane reached about 10,000 feet altitude, what they didn't know was this. There was a crack in the fuselage of the plane. When the pressure became so great, it actually ripped away part of that airplane, causing a vacuuming, a sucking effect. And everything that was not held down or strapped down was pulled out of that plane including Claribel Lansing, airline attendant, sucked out into eternity to face God. Oh, my friend, you need to understand about living, dying, and living again. It is certain. It is coming. You have an appointment with God, and you need to be prepared for that day.
One thing that's true in life is that death comes for everybody. No matter of your age, of your race, your religion, how much money you've made in life, death will come for you. And it's important that you be prepared when that day comes, because sometimes death will come unexpectedly. It's important that you be prepared, because death will come for you.
I remember when I first saw the World Trade Center disaster, when those two planes flew into those buildings. What a horrifying event, creating so much terror and fear. I remember watching people run out of the building and down the street. I watched as the towers fell and that big cloud of smoke and debris followed them down the street. I began to think about all the people inside the building that were going to die that day. Most of them, if not all of them, came to work that day thinking it was just another day at the office, probably thinking about the work they had to do, perhaps even thinking about where they would go for lunch, maybe thinking about when they would get home that night, playing with their children, being with their family. They had no idea before those planes crashed that they were actually living their last day on planet Earth. That's the way death is. Many times it can come suddenly and unexpectedly. I remember seeing some of those people jump out of the window. What an amazing thing to see people jump out of a 60, 70 story building to certain death on the concrete below. And I asked myself, why? What would make a person jump out of a building to a concrete death? And the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, William, they're jumping from the building to get away from the fire. What is death anyway? You know, many years ago, doctors said that death was when your heart stopped beating. But then they invented a machine that could keep your heart going even after you were gone. Then they said, well, death is when your brain waves cease. But they have a machine now that can keep you alive even when your brain stops working. The Bible teaches us that death is separation. It is when your soul separates from your body. You see, my dear friends, this flesh and bone body that you have is not the real you. The real you is inside that body. It's called your soul. It is comprised of your will, your intellect, your emotions. The soul is that part of you that's going to live forever. One day this old body is going to stop working, but when your body stops working, your soul will separate from that body and go on living somewhere else. That's what death is. Death is separation. When your soul separates from your body. Well, you say, where does the soul go? When it separates from your body and leaves your body, it goes on living somewhere else. Where does it go? Well, the Bible says that your soul will live forever, either in a place called heaven or a place called hell. Oh, my friend, that's the whole story of the Bible, that you were created by God to live forever. You are an eternal being. Now, once this old body is going to die, but when your body dies, the soul man, the real you, will leave that body. God created it that way. And God wants you to come and live with Him. He's made a perfect place called heaven for those who will believe in Him. But the Bible says that we have sinned against God. In fact, the Bible says we have broken God's law into 1,000 pieces. We have rebelled against God. We've lived selfish and self-centered lives. And the Bible says God loves us, but God hates sin. And God has declared the wages of sin is death. Because we have sinned against God, we're all doomed to hell. And there's nothing we can do to save ourselves. But the Bible says God loved us so much, He sent His Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus left the glory of heaven and He came to planet Earth. He took all of our sins and He died in our place that we might live. And the Bible says if we will turn from our sin and we will give our lives to Christ, God will forgive us. God will save us.
Being saved is more than just knowing about God. It's knowing God in a real and personal way. And it's turning from the world and the world's ways and turning from your sin and turning to God. And the Bible calls it being born again.
Being saved is the most important thing in your life. And I'm not talking about being saved the Baptist way or the Methodist way or the Catholic way or any other denomination way. I'm talking about being saved God's way. Because, my dear friends, if you're not saved God's way, then you're not saved at all. And if we are born again by the Spirit of God, the benefit of being a child of God is that one day, when this body stops working, our soul will go to be with God in heaven. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." He said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." He said, "I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Oh, my dear friends, heaven is a prepared place, but it's only for prepared people. Heaven is a perfect place. No sadness, no sickness, no death. When a man goes to heaven, he lives in the glory of God forever and ever. And it all depends on what he's done with Jesus. But the same Bible says, as wonderful as heaven is, hell is awful. The Bible calls it a lake of fire, a burning pit, a place where men have no rest, a place where men are separated from God for all eternity, a place where men are tormented. The man who went to hell in the Bible, the rich man, he cried out and said, "Father, I'm so tormented in this flame. Would you please let that old dirty beggar Lazarus put one of his dirty, filthy fingers in some water and just touch the tip of my tongue?" Oh, friends, listen. The Bible says that death is when your soul separates from your body, and it goes either to a place called heaven to be with God or a place called hell to be separated from God forever. And the good news is God lets you choose where you'll spend eternity. That's the whole story of the Bible, that God has given you the choice of heaven or hell.
The problem is we are sinners before a holy God. We're guilty of crimes against our own Creator. And one day we must stand before God and give an account of our lives. Heaven or hell hang in the balance. That's why being saved is so important. Why go to hell when God gives you the opportunity to go to heaven?
In the New Testament, Jesus tells a story about a rich farmer who one year has a tremendous crop. In fact, the harvest is so great, his old barns will not hold the increase. So he decides to tear down the old barns and build new, bigger, and better barns. He does this. He fills them up with his harvest. Then he sets back and says, "Now I've got it made. I'm going to eat, drink, and be merry." But God speaks to him and says, "You're a fool, because tonight your soul is required of thee. Then who's going to receive all the things you have worked for?" The Bible says that we have sinned against God, but God has made a way to stay out of hell. And a man can be born again, he can be saved, he can stand in the very presence of God for all eternity. But listen, friends, 30 million people die every year. That's an average of 90 people every 60 seconds, and 90% of them have gone straight into hell. You see, my friends, you've got to make a choice. God doesn't send anybody to hell. God has done everything necessary. See, a man makes his own choice, his own decision. And some of you are going to do that today. Some of you are going to say, "You know, I don't care about that Jesus stuff. I'm not concerned about that." But when you make that decision, you have sealed your destiny. And unless God gives you another chance and you repent and give your life to Christ, you're going to spend eternity in hell. And many people do that. Many people love their sin so much that they would rather risk hell rather than humble themselves before God and be born again by the Spirit of God. Oliver B. Green was a great preacher. He wrote a book called Sentenced to Die. And in that book, he told the story of the day he went back to his hometown to visit an old friend who was in the hospital dying. This man was 70 years of age, and when Oliver B. Green came to his room, he was nothing but skin and bones. He couldn't talk. He couldn't respond. And Oliver B. Green got to his bedside. He began to talk to him about life and death, heaven and hell. He talked to him about the things of God, and he said, listen, if you want to give your heart to Christ and be saved, he said, just pray with me right now and ask God to save you. But the man could not pray. So Oliver B. Green took him by the hand and said, listen, friend, I'm going to pray the prayer asking God to save you. If you agree with this prayer, just squeeze my hand and God will hear you. The man made no move. Oliver B. Green left the hospital. The next morning before he went out of town, he went back to the hospital to say his final goodbye. When he got to the hospital, the nurse said, Dr. Green, what did you do yesterday? He said, I don't understand. She said, your friend has not spoken in 2 weeks. He's not moved a muscle. He's not been able to feed himself or say a word. She said, but this morning when we came into the room, he was sitting at the top of his bed. He was waving his arms. He was kicking his feet. He was screaming to the top of his lungs, my feet are on fire. My feet are on fire. My feet are on, somebody save me. My feet are on fire. She said, 4 men had to hold him down and he died. Oh, my friend, today people are so drugged and sedated for pain that most people today don't see the horror of dying without Christ and falling straight in to a devil's hell. Sarah Winchester was a woman who wanted to live forever. Sarah was married to Henry Winchester, the man who invented the famous Winchester repeating rifle. Henry became a very wealthy man, and when Henry died, Sarah became a very wealthy widow. And Sarah wanted more than anything to live forever. So Sarah consulted a fortune teller, a witch. And this fortune teller told her, Sarah, if you'll do one thing, you'll never die. If you'll start building a house and never stop building. So Sarah began to build on this great house. She built on it day after day, month after month, year after year. She spent millions of dollars. She hired thousands of workers. She built on this wonderful, marvelous home for 38 years because if you never stop building, you never die. You can see the home that Sarah built if you go to San Jose, California, there in the Santa Clara Valley. At one time, it was more than 7 stories high. The home itself covers several acres of land. There are hundreds of rooms. There are thousands of windows. Because if you never stop building, you never die. But after 38 years of building, one night the icy finger of death came walking down one of those hallways into one of those rooms, and death found Sarah and took her to eternity. Oh, my friend, you cannot hide from death. Death is coming for you and death is coming for me. And death may be coming a lot sooner than any of us ever expected. What about you? If you were to die right now, where would you spend eternity? Would your soul leave your body and go to heaven to be with God? Or would your soul fall into the lake of fire? It would all depend on what you've done with Jesus. Do you know for sure if you died today that you'd go to heaven? You say, William, I've got to be honest. I don't know 100% for sure if I died today, I'd go to heaven. In fact, William, I don't know what would happen if I died today. But to think about dying and going to hell, it frightens me. I don't want that to happen, I know. And I don't want to stand before God one day and find out, though I've been a church member and lived a pretty good life, that I was really lost because I hadn't been born again. You say, William, I want to be saved. William, I know that life is nothing but a vapor. I know that I could die at any moment. And William, I want to be prepared for that. I want to be able to stand in the presence of God as a true child of God. But you say, William, I don't know what to do. What must I do to be prepared to die? Well, the Bible says, except you repent, you'll perish. That word repent means you've got to change your mind. You've got to change your mind about sin, change your mind about God. You see, you've got to see that sin is not against people. Sin is against your Creator. And sin is not a small thing. Sin is rebellion against God. You've got to see it God's way. You've got to agree with God. You've got to say, God, you're right. I'm a sinner. God, I have lived a sinful, rebellious life, but God, I'm sorry. and I want to change my mind. I want to see things your way. I want to agree with you. And God, I want to turn away from my rebellion. And I want to place my faith and trust in Jesus Christ, Him and Him alone. I want Him to be my God, my boss, my master. I surrender my will to Him. And my friend, if you'll do that, God will save your soul. God will change you, and He will glorify Himself through you. And you can do that right now. Right where you're sitting, I'm going to ask you, will you be saved? Will you repent? Will you admit that you're wrong and turn your life over to Christ? Just kneel right where you are, just you and God, and you can ask God to save you right now. If you'll open your heart to God, if you'll repent and give your life to Him, He'll save your soul. I'm going to pray a prayer called the Prayer of Salvation. There's nothing special about this prayer. It's not the prayer that saves. What saves is when you open your heart to God and you turn from your sin and give your life to Christ. The prayer merely puts together in a form that we can understand. I want you to pray this prayer after me, but more important than praying, I want you to open your heart to God and repent and let God save your soul. Pray with me right now. If God is speaking to your heart right now, if you are willing to repent, if you are willing to take Christ as your Lord and Savior, then pray with me right now. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I know that I'm a sinner, and I know I cannot save myself. But God, I believe You love me, and I believe Jesus died for me to pay for all my sin. The best I know how, I repent of my sin. I turn from my sin, and I receive Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. I commit my life to Him. I believe in my heart that God has raised Him from the dead. Forgive me of my sin, Lord. Come into my heart and save me.